Good morning. That was encouraging, wasn't it? I really like what VBS is doing. Every time I ever went to VBS, it was always in a church setting. They are going outside of the walls, they're being bold. They're going where the people are. I just love that faith. That is awesome, isn't it? I need to tell you a story. We have three good friends in this church. There's several good friends, but this is a fishing story. So you have to figure out whether it's true or not, okay? Gene Pommels, Bobby Pommels, and, we'll say Justin in this case. They all went fishing together. But the backdrop of the story is that Bobby and Gene had been fishing at the certain lake for several years. They knew where to go. They knew where the fish were biting and so forth. Anyway, after a while, Gene said, "Man, I drank too much Coke. I got to relieve myself. Please excuse me." He edged himself over the boat and starts walking on the water to the shore. A few minutes later, he comes back and he goes, "Oh, that feels so much better." It wasn't long before Bobby's like, "Oh, guys, please excuse me." He edges over the boat. He comes back a few minutes later. It wasn't long before Justin was looking at these guys. He's like, "Man, I'm a missionary to overseas, and these guys are walking on water. If they can do it, I have to do that too, right?" Justin lets himself over the edge of the boat. Bloop, he sinks. You see his hat floating on top of the water. Bobby turns to his father and said, "You know, I guess we could have told him where those stones were, couldn't we?" Please turn in your Bible to James 4:7. We live in a life of great hope because of what Christ has done for us. He has made so many things possible for us. He's given us so many opportunities. We got to be real careful, though. Let me explain to you. I'm going to tell you a really sad story, and it's going to be hard to believe because it's a fish story, but it really happened. I went fishing this week with my brother and my family members. We went down to South Padre Island, fished off a private pier, and I caught everything but trout and red. I caught fish, but they weren't what I wanted to catch. I fished for about 2.5 hours till I was tired, till I was frustrated. Mosquitoes had chewed me up. Now, my daughter, on the other hand, she pulled in a trout. My point is this: we're trying the same bait, but how we present it is very important. She caught a keeper. I caught piggy perch, hardheads, skipjack, nothing that you could eat. In life, we got to be careful because we have an enemy. He doesn't like us. He wants the church to be distracted because he knows we are a worthy foe. And so he wants us to be very ineffective. He wants us to be fishers of men like I was a fisherman, not catching, not being effective. So in our life, we have to be very careful that we don't fall, that we don't take the bait. When I was about 9 years old, my oldest brother came home one day, and he had a beautiful tennis racket. And what really made this racket special was that it had blue tennis strings, and I'd never seen blue tennis strings before. Now they're very common, all different colors. And I said, "Bill, can I hit with your tennis racket?" And Bill said, "No, it's my tennis racket. You can't use my racket." I said, "Okay." About a week passed, and my mom served dessert. And on this particular day, it was a slice of hot apple pie. I couldn't wait to eat it. And as I was getting ready to eat it, my brother Bill turned to me and he said, "David, you know that tennis racket that I have?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "If you give me your apple pie, I will give you my tennis racket." I thought for a moment. I said, "That's a good deal. I'll take that offer." So he handed me his tennis racket. So I had a tennis racket. Well, about 2 weeks later, I heard my other two brothers arguing over this tennis racket. And Paul was saying to Joe, "No, that's not your tennis racket. That's my tennis racket." And Joe, the older brother, said, "No, that's not your racket. Bill gave it to me." I was like, "What? Here I gave up my apple pie? What is going on with this story?" I knew it wouldn't be any good to argue with them, so I waited till my brother Bill got home. I said, "Bill, where's my tennis racket? I can't find it anywhere." "Oh, David, I forgot to tell you. I had borrowed that from Danny Young, and he asked for his racket back, so I gave him his racket back. So my brother had scammed all three of us for that same tennis racket. I gave up my apple pie. I don't know what my brothers gave up, but we were all not, none of us were happy campers. You see, I took the bait. But you know what? Bill never tricked me again. I learned from that lesson, and we need to be careful because we have an enemy, and he wants us so caught up into current events instead of godly events that we get detracted and we get into, no, you can't do that. The Bible preaches against that, and no, you can't do that, and no, you can't do that. That's not how you reach the world, okay? Is there instruction for the believers, things that they should do and they shouldn't do? Yes. But when we're dealing with those who are outside the family, it's not about the do's and the don'ts. It's about the love of God. I love that video. These guys from Asia, they've never been scripted. And what are they doing? They're talking about the hope. One guy said, I can be in my dorm all alone, but I'm not alone because God is with me. Another one's talking about the love of God. That's what the kingdom is about, right? That's what we need to be about. We can't get caught up in the trivial things, and I get caught up in the trivial things. I can vouch for that. But we need to stay focused. We need to stay about what the kingdom is about. The kingdom is a whole lot more than do's and don'ts. It's about abundance. It's about forgiveness. It's about joy. It's about peace. And that's what we need to share. Please turn in your Bible to 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 through 5, if you have your Bible. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war against the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but are divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. We are destroying speculations and every thought, every lofty thought raised up against the knowledge of God. And we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. I don't think any of us in here realize how much Satan fears the church. He absolutely fears the church because we have Christ in us. He understands that power, but many times we get distracted. We don't get to understand the immense power that God has given his body. And so if he can keep us distracted and keep us on things that are trivial and things that aren't important, we're not ever going to have the impact that he wants us to have. And here it says that we need to take every thought captive. So we need to be careful what's coming through our mind. Is that godly? Is that the news? About 3 months ago, I just quit watching the nightly news. And that's a big deal for me because I'm really up on current events. But it's just gotten so depressing, whether it's ISIS, whether it's the Greek economy, whether it's the line goes on. I can list 10 or 15 different things. Supreme Court justice decisions. There's so many things that can be discouraging or distracting. So I can focus on that. Or I can focus on what's before me, the kingdom of God, and sharing his love with those who are in need. So what do we do to make sure we don't take the bait? The first thing we need to make sure and do is to prepare ourselves. In 1 Peter 1:13, Peter said to the believers, gird up your mind. And he goes into a lot of description. Back in that day, men wore robes or tunics. And when it was time to work, or if they had to go to battle, they would take their robes and they would bring them way up high. And they would put them under their loincloth so that they could move about. They were much more effective, whether it's work, whether it was battle. And that's what God's saying we need to do. We need to gird up our mind. We need to be focused on the kingdom. We need to make that a priority. It's not just going to happen. I can assure you. You know what? They have Wimbledon on. I want to see who won the finals today between the men. Baseball's in full season. There's so many things that I can get distracted with. I'm not saying those things aren't good, but I'm just saying that I need to make sure that by my primary focus at the end of the day, has been about the kingdom, right? We need to stay focused. And what I like is it said, in 1 Peter 3:15, it said, be prepared to share the hope that is in you. Now, you got to understand, when Peter's writing this, they think this was around 64 AD. And at this time, Nero was in full swing. This is when the lions, the believers were being thrown to the lions. Believers were hiding in catacombs. Some were being cut in half. Families were ripped apart. We think that times are tough in America. We have no idea. We have no idea what they were going through at this time. It was hell on earth. So you would think that Peter would write a comforting note like, hey, be there for each other. You know, God's going to come through. No, he's saying, be prepared to share the hope that is within you. Because as times get darker, that hope becomes brighter. And we need to be prepared to share the hope, the living hope, the joy that God has for us. A lot of people have heard the quote from St. Francis, it's, preach the gospel at all times, and when necessary, use words. I love the simplicity of what he said, but there's another quote that isn't as well known, and I think it may be as potent. It is no use walking anywhere to preach unless our walking is our preaching. So we need to be living it. We need to be part of this. As my father was getting older in age, he was in his 80s. His air conditioner failed on him, and he was getting ready to call an AC repairman. And a man that lived two doors down, he came over and he said, Mr. Gray, I do air conditioning for a living. I would like to look at that for you free of charge. We'll just see if we can save you some money. And he went in and repaired my father's air conditioner, wouldn't charge him a cent. And it sort of bothered my father because my father didn't want to take advantage of this man. And he said, you know what, Mr. Gray, I feel like God wants me to look out for you and your wife. And that touched my dad so much. I was very, very close to my father. So when he told me something, it really had an impact on me. And he said, David, I don't go to church very much. He said, but this man does. And I am so touched by what he did. And that man said, listen, I know how to do other things too. If you need help with anything, I'm two houses down. Please call me. I really mean it. I'd be glad to help you. That had a huge impact on my father. And I still remember that. So guys, by the grace of God, when God gives you the opportunity, look for that opportunity to be able to share the hope. The man never preached to my father. My father knew he was a believer. But what he did, his actions spoke for him, right? So we need to be sensitive to that opportunity. And we have to be balanced. I was talking to a young man. He was telling me one of his college professors at college was saying that, you know, sometimes in the church we get in a struggle. It's like there's two chairs. One chair, hey, you can't do this, and you can't do that, and you can't do this, and you can't do that. And it's a bunch of do's and don'ts. It's the law. And the other chair over here, these are the believers where, hey, it's okay if you go out and you do this. And, that's okay. You know, God loves you. He'll forgive you if you do that. And what he's emphasizing is that there's law and there's grace. And if you go too much law, you miss the will of God. And if you go too much grace, you miss the will of God. So what are we to be done? We are to be led by the Spirit of God. And you know what? God wants to lead us, right? It's not like a mystery. God absolutely wants to lead us. He wants to be our Heavenly Father. He doesn't want it to be a mystery. So let's just believe that God's not only going to give us the hope, but he's going to lead us into those opportunities, right? And most importantly, I want to encourage you to keep getting up. It says in Proverbs, many of us have this memorized, a wise man falls down seven times and he continues to get up. You know, I started studying that and I started thinking about it. I thought, that's interesting. It doesn't say that a wise man will fall one time. And I was encouraged because I've fallen a lot more than one time. It said he'll fall seven times. I'm glad it didn't say he won't fall 700 times, because I'd be really discouraged too, right? But the emphasis of the verse is that we get up. Some of us have been hit by a freight train lately. It can be health issues, it can be financial, it can be stress, it can be so many things that are coming to take away our joy. And they can be huge sometimes. And we can choose whether to stay on the ground or we can choose to get back up. Please consider Peter. They're at the Last Supper. The Last Supper. This is just before Jesus is taken. And he's sitting there arguing with the disciples about he's going to be at the right hand of God. Can you imagine Jesus hearing this conversation with his disciples? How discouraging that would be. He knows that he's getting ready to die. And his disciples are arguing over something that's so trivial. And perhaps even more sad was that out of all the time that he's with them, they did not understand the kingdom of God. They still thought it was a king coming. They didn't know it was a prince of peace. And Jesus must have been thinking all this time, what is going to happen to them when I pass away? Then we go to the next point, and Peter says, I'll never deny you. Of course, Jesus knew he was going to deny him three times. You know what I love about Peter? Millions of people have learned about what Peter did, but what I love is that Peter got back up. And I have been a Peter, and every one of us have been a Peter. We've all fallen. It would have been so easy for Peter to give up. Man, this is his chance. He's up to bat. He can hit a home run. No. He can catch a Super Bowl pass. No. And the biggest moment of his life, he blew it two times. It must have been so discouraging. But Peter got back up. I'm so glad. That brings incredible hope to me that that man would get back up after all that discouragement, after all that failure. And we need to have the same attitude. In Hebrews 12:2, it says, look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. So let me ask you, because I don't know you, many of you personally, only God knows your heart. Is God the author of your faith? I don't know. Is he the author of your faith? Because he needs to be the author of our faith, right? And if he is the author of your faith, is he going to be the finisher of your faith? Because you're going to choose that too. Are you going to get distracted, discouraged, frustrated, and give up? Or is Jesus Christ going to be the finisher of our faith? He's going to be the finisher, right? Amen. I would like you to watch this video. Thank you.
It's meaning, but you might be surprised to find some hope. Maybe you're wondering where love is. You may feel it's far away from here. Maybe you're wondering where I am. Might be surprised to find I'm near. And when your life is tossed and turning, and you are on the raging sea, I'm coming for you from the water. Then you will know that you. If you're tempted to give up the fight, reach out your hand and I will lead you. I will be your strong arm in the light.
The setting was the 1992 Olympics. Derek Redmond, odds makers were saying he was going to medal. Don't know, gold, silver, bronze. He was very close to his father. He told his father, even if he blew the race, took off too early, whatever, regardless of the outcome, he was going to finish the race. He was going to finish the race. As you saw, about third way through the race, his hamstring tore, completely severed. Immense pain, collapses. And after everybody had finished crossing, he got back up and continued that race. And the man who assisted him was his father. And the officials were trying to get their father off the track. And the father would have nothing. He would have nothing to do with them. He was going to be there for his son. He was going to be there to help him finish that race. That's how our Heavenly Father is for us. If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us, who can be against us, right? So I encourage you. I tell you today, God is for you. If any of you need encouragement for any reason, I encourage you to come down here and join me in prayer. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your goodness. And we thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. And we thank you that you're always going to be there for us, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Thank you.